To those of you, hi. Those of you who don't know me, my name's Sam. Been a member here for several years. We want to talk about faith today. But I'd just like to take a quick moment and just pray over the service. So, Father, I just thank you for your dominion here over the service. And I just thank you that your word comes forth in power. I just thank you, Lord, for increase. I thank you for change. Thank you that we are a real part of you. Just thank you, Lord. Amen. I just wanted to put something to you, like, just say you're in a position where you make $12 an hour, and, you know, you do your budget, you look at things, and you're like, man, I want to make 20, 25. And so you start praying about it before the Lord, and, you know, you're in this place of hope to, like, double your income. And so you look at the word, you look at Hebrews 11:1, it says that faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. And so you start praying, and the Holy Spirit starts putting things before you to, like, you know, maybe grow, learn some new things at your job, and you learn these things, and, you know, several months go by to where you're putting together this plan, and God is speaking to you. And then all of a sudden, you get a call, and you get a raise, and you get promoted, and you're making $25 an hour. So at that point in time, when you're making $25 an hour, you're not in this place of hope anymore, or in a place of faith. That is something that you have, right? And so God, you know, we learn to, like, work faith. Like, we know the spirit of faith. And it's like when God places something in you, it's like it becomes something not that you're in hope for anymore, but it's something that you have. And that faith is, like, manifested into you, and it's real, and it exists. It is yours. And we know that, you know, God gives us the free gift of salvation. And that is something that he has given to us and placed into us. You know, Jesus said, when I am lifted up, all men will be drawn unto me. And it says that before the foundation of the world, you are a part of me. You are in me. God knows you. God has known you since the foundation of the world. It's not an accident that you got saved. You were drawn by Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit because you are a member of God. You are a part of him, and you are drawn into him, and he places himself in you. Amen? So it says in, like, 1st or 2nd Peter, one of the two, you are born of an incorruptible seed. That seed cannot be distorted by the devil. It can't be tainted. It can't be stolen. Who you are is incorruptible. The seed is absolutely perfect. And that seed has been placed into you and exists. That seed is growing and manifesting in power and victory through your soul. Because you are a part of God. You are a very real part of him. And that seed is him. It says that you may know what the hope of your calling is. Well, you're called to be a son. The hope of your calling is that you may know who you are and have an awareness in your soul that you are a son of God, that you are one with him. The This isn't something that you're trying to get. This isn't something that is going to happen. This is something that has happened and exists in you. This is real. This is right now. The power of change, the power of God, is alive in you. It is in your soul, and you know it. And you have come to know it more intimately. You are a blessing. It's just like, you know, when Paige was talking about how she's in this room and all these people are just drawn to her, it's because of who she is in Christ, that these people want her to come and pray for her. They want this. They want this life. I've heard so many testimonies about people that just go into a room, they're in an area, and people just know there's something different. They know that the Lord is in that room. They feel the power. That is your identity, that you are a son of God. You know, it says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. And it's like, you know, the devil, he tries to play so many tricks on people about their identity. You know, he tries to make them think that they're these sinners, that they're, you know, underneath the devil, or that they're these bad people, they're thieves, or whatever. All these negative, negative things. But the truth is that we are not. It says in the Romans chapter 7, that if there's sin that happens, if it dwells in your members, but it is not you. It's just something that's dead, it's in your flesh, and it's going to pass away. But you are born again a spirit. You are a spirit, and you are one with God. The devil cannot lie to you or trick you into thinking that you're something that you're not. What God has placed into you is real, it is powerful, and it is effective. Who you are is overcoming power. I've known people that have overcome drug addictions, have overcome sickness, all kinds of just super life problems that in the world you do not see change, but in God they do change. They fall away and they are destroyed by the power of what is alive in you. Your identity as a son of God, the life of Jesus that manifests in you. Now, we use that word awareness a lot here, and I believe that that word is just like your soul becoming aware of the what God has manifested in you. Just like you're knowing who you are. You knowing the power of God in your life. You know that you are in victory. You know that you can change. You know that you are put on this planet to destroy the works of the devil and not be subject to them. Amen? I think I'd like to pass the mic. Christian, would you like to come up?
Thank you, Father. So we are here to talk about faith. Now, who is talking is very important. Yeah, who is more important than what? I came to the conclusion that you cannot talk about the kingdom of God separated from identity. If you try to do that, it becomes weird. becomes something like, okay, how many books do I need to read? How many people do I need to interview? But if you know who you are, if you are solid in your identity, then kingdom is being revealed to you. Amen? Yes, you are alive. Praise God. So, one of the first things that we realize, as Sam was alluding to, awareness. One of the first things we realize when we come into the new creation is that we are one. We are one. And not because we do something or because we strive for something or because we apply the right formula, is because that's who we are. You are born into the kingdom of God as one. It's just as simple as that. Remember, it was said here, I think Val said it a few weeks ago, oneness is not something we realize, it's something we keep. Yes? Say yes. Okay, good. How is this guy knowing all these things? Because I'm behind that lens every Sunday, every Friday. I'm there. You don't see me, I see you. So, you become aware of oneness, and there is very little understanding coming out of your flesh. It's very little understanding what oneness is, what oneness does, how does it look. But we have, guess what we have as our helper to understand? Faith. So Hebrews 11, verse 2 says, by faith we understand. So this is my focus for this little time we have together, is the understanding that rises up inside of us by faith. But remember, it's not because we are so special and we did the right thing. It's because we are one. Amen? So let's do an exercise as being one and faith helping you understand things. So this is heavy. I wish something will help me here. No?
It's coming, it's
coming. See? Oneness created understanding in Shem that I need a podium. Isn't that simple? It's not very complicated. Amen? So you will find yourself looking around and doing stuff. But it's not more important what you do, but who you are. Who is doing that? Oneness is doing that. Amen? Okay. So I want to read a couple of verses from... oneness is not... is working. Anyways. A couple of verses from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And it's the last two verses of chapter 4. Come on, 2 Corinthians. Oh, gadgets. Okay, beginning with verse 17. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, is working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we do not look at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So, I want to start with this little exercise. Let's imagine. We've been doing this imagining exercises quite a bit now, and you know, the blood of Christ cleanses us, cleanses even our imagination. So our imagination will not run wild into the things of the flesh or deception. Our imagination, cleansed by the blood of Christ, will lead us into victory, from glory to glory, from faith to faith. Amen? So let's just imagine I have a ball, like a dodgeball, you know, those that are plasticky. And imagine that I paint that ball with fresh paint, and then I press it against this wall. As I remove it from the wall, what do you see? Well, paint. What shape do you see? A circle. Yeah, a circle. Let's stay with the circle. Circle is the correct answer. Now, let's take a frisbee. Paint it with the same paint, yeah? And while the paint is fresh, let's press it against the same wall. What do you see? A circle. Then let's take the frisbee and the ball away, bring somebody, put that somebody in front of the wall and say, tell me what this is. What can they tell you? What can they tell you? Only what they see, yeah? I see two circles. Can you tell me more? No, not really. See, things that are seen and things that are not seen. Yeah? If you ask them, what created these circles? Well, a very talented painter. Yeah? Where is the reality? The reality is not in this realm. Yes? Who's going to take us into the realm of reality? Faith. By faith, we understand. Our relationship with faith is not with an emotion, is not with a part of our brain, is not with some sort of a New Age exercise where we get enlightened. And no, our relationship with faith as new creation is with a living being. Faith is a living being. And our relationship with faith is oneness. You believe that? You know why can you believe that? Because of faith. Faith is telling you, I am in you and you are in me. That's the definition of oneness. Yeah? You in me and I in you. That's it. Oneness. So you ask faith, yeah, as a new creation, what is the reality that created that imprint on the wall? And faith will form the understanding. By faith, we understand that the things that are seen were created from things that are not seen. What gains our victory against the world is faith. Faith. Now, I want to bring you a step further. Okay, I have understanding, so the Bible says you have to be careful with so much understanding, so much knowledge, so much this, because you get puffed up. The fear of the Lord is there to keep you from puffing yourself up. Yeah. And I want to bring to your attention freedom. When you have understanding, you have freedom to move, freedom to choose, freedom to use something, freedom to discern. In 1991, right before we came here to the United States, couple of missionaries from Austria invited us to visit them in Vienna. So me and my wife, fresh out of communism, the most complicated device that we've seen in our kitchens were refrigerators. That was it. That was the most complicated thing. So we walked into this people's home, and we look. Now I know what it is. Then I look at the box with a keypad with some sort of a door. Now I know it's a microwave. Now, do you think I had freedom to use that device? Say no. Who in his right mind start doing something that they don't understand? Do you see how faith builds an understanding so we can move freely in the kingdom of God? Not timidly, not, oh, you know, I'm not sure. No, with confidence. That's why understanding is there. So we understand, yeah, this was created by a ball. I know what a ball is. I know what a frisbee is. I have freedom to look at these things and discern and move. But somebody who is not in that relationship with faith, all they can do all day long, they sit in front of the wall, and that's all they do. They speculate. They can measure. They can write books about it. Yeah. And you know what Jesus said at the end of chapter 6 in Matthew? This is everything the world concerns itself with. But you don't be like that. You seek first the kingdom of God. Amen? And in the kingdom of God, faith is revealing to us these realities that are bringing freedom. Freedom to the Son. I know what this is. Yeah? Another aspect of understanding is peace. I know peace is a great, great spirit. And we enjoy peace. But have you experienced peace because you understand? Yes, because I understand, I have peace. Nothing by any means shall harm you. When, this is a good verse, recite. But when understanding is coming and is proving to you that really nothing can harm you, peace is there. Peace. So understanding that is brought to our insight by faith is very, very precious. Paul says, yes, I will pray with tongues, but I will pray with understanding. This is the understanding he was talking about. Not understanding from reading so many books and being at the feet of Gamaliel for so many years. No, was the understanding by faith. Amen? So I want to bring you into this final exercise of creating, allowing the faith to create understanding inside of you. So you sit here Sunday after Sunday, Friday after Friday, and all you see is just these few chairs, some more empty than filled. But do you think that's all? Ask faith. And you know what faith is going to tell you? It was talking to me this morning. Look through that lens. And through that lens, faith is going to open an understanding that there are hundreds, if not thousands of people right here with you in oneness, believing. gaining victory over the world because of faith. So come excited every Sunday, every Friday, because it's not only what you see. It's much, much more. And I am the living proof of that. You can sense me right now beyond the fact that, oh, look at that guy, he's this tall, he's this wide, he's this. Beyond that, you can sense me that I belong. Yeah, isn't that true? It's because of that lens. I am always watching, not as a badge of honor, look at me. No, because I love you, because we are one. And faith is going to create more and more understanding, more and more freedom. It's going to establish us in peace. Yeah? Amen? Amen? Amen. I bless you and I thank you. I thank you for your faithfulness.
Thank you for the stand of unity. You stand in one, the one stand. Okay, just a sec. I know you guys like to look at the screen. Couple of minutes. I just want to tell you that you are in the right place at the right time. Every time somebody's asking me, hey, I'm in the area or I'm looking for a church, for so many years, I could not recommend anything else. Because that's what I love. This is the right place. This is where it's beyond the teaching. And it takes a commitment from the ones that are coming around because we want to establish relationships. I noticed that lots of the people that are coming and going are people that we have not had a relationship. We don't know them as friends. We don't meet them on a Tuesday, on a Wednesday, on a Thursday. We just see them on Sunday. And they come and they go. I think this is an amazing place to build relationships and to know that you are loved and you are prayed for and you're part of something that's alive. Okay. The belonging sense comes into people a lot because, people know their name and they have their little chair, the pew on a Sunday or Wednesday. But that's not it. This is, you want to be part of something that's alive, something that grows, something that your mind is blown away every time you hear a word. Not somewhere where you, it's okay, yeah, that's his opinion. But something that challenges you to let that true life that comes from the Lord, that's inside of you, manifest, change you. The Lord did not save you to leave you as you were. The Lord saved you to change you. And most of you that went through the process says, praise God, I want to be changed. I want to be changed. And these are things that are happening with us all the time. Okay, they are words that he gives us. They are realities that he reveals to us. And as we grow into that, there are so many supernatural things that are manifesting. I mean, hopefully in a week or two, if you, keep listening to this, there will be more people here experiencing what Paige experienced. And I'm thinking, yeah, it's hard to come with a testimony because, like, that's kind of how I live every day. Unless I journal it, I'm not sure which one should I say. And that's for you too. I know that. Sometimes, yeah, if it's 6 hours, stands out. Yeah, it's like, especially if you didn't plan to go there for so many hours. But there's so many unusual things that the Lord brings inside you because you are not a creature of this earth only. You are on this earth, and this body of yours is the smallest part of you. And the most temporary part of you. And then everything in the media and the movies is just focusing on the smallest part of you, right? Well, it can get you to cry sometimes. Still not that deep enough, right? It's like all about, you know, the luxury, the comfort, the nice foods, the healthy foods. It's just about your body. And guess what? You know, if you make it to 85, 90, you're a strong person. What is 85 years compared to eternity? So, you know, what is that? A little drop in the ocean? Can you measure the drops of the ocean? Nobody tried. Eternity. That is the real part of you. When you talk about one in definitions and faith and the spiritual kingdom, that's the part of you that should interest you. Because that's alive. And that's spiritual. And that's forever. Do you think the streets of gold of heaven are very nice, clean streets of Beaverton, Oregon? Do you think they send some little things and just kind of pave the street very nicely and then put some little dust of gold on it? Do you think the gates of the city are just like some kind of a nice, beautiful, ornated things made somewhere in a place in India? You know, cut out of, you know, all kind of special minerals that are, no. That's not how it goes. Those are alive. They don't rust. They don't need maintenance. You don't need to go and put some little oil on the hinges. Sorry, Tony, no work for you in heaven. You're happy, I'm sure. But, you know, no plumbing stuff. Everything is alive. And that is the part of you that your soul desires. You know, all these hurts and the pain of relationships that come and go, all this temporary stuff. You know, that hurts us, and we try to, you know, unfortunately, lots of the concepts, ideas, definitions in religion, they come out of those hurts. Insufficiency, limitations. People design religion because of what they don't have, what they don't know. They go through that pain and it's like, well, has to be somewhere out there that understands me. They place this God in the misunderstanding or no understanding or hard to find place. That's not why he sent Jesus here. He says, I want you to know me. I want you to understand there is this spiritual reality where you belong. I've known you. I want you to come to understand that. So what does it take for someone that's raised for years in the conscious of this material thing and some little soul feelings once in a while, what does it take to say, you know, all this universe that I created, I'm surrounded with, is actually not the real thing? What does it take? And I have a whole reality of things that's absolutely more real than this stand that I'm touching. Because I have spiritual senses. I can taste. I can see. I can hear. Interesting. I have spiritual senses. I can connect with things that are absolutely real. So Jesus comes and says, truly, truly, I say to you that you cannot come wherever I'm going. And people are like, come on, we know all your hiding places. You're from Nazareth, right? Of course we can come. And what? You're going to go to Samaritans? That's what they were thinking. He's going to go and hide there because he don't want to go there. We're too holy for Samaritans. It completely misunderstanding, because all that they could think was carnal, material dimensions. You are born again to start thinking, understanding something that's absolutely out of this realm and live naturally supernatural. Come to a place where you start praying for the baby. The Lord is showing you angels going right there and just blessing that. Why? Because the spiritual realm is real. We're not just saying words. Something happens when you say the prayer. I mentioned this to you because I've been raised in, I call it religion, in the way, you know, with all honesty, sincerity, I was seeking God. And I remember the first time when I realized that actually this prayer stuff, it's something alive. Something happens. And I was like in my really dedicated prayer time, and I felt this tap on my shoulder. And I heard the voice and says, who are you praying to? That was a wake up time, wake up call. Lord, I've been saying my prayers for so long. Who are you praying to? This realm is alive. Our God is a living God. We're not learning to say prayers and sing songs. One time he showed me that most of the Christians, they pass from darkness to light. And he showed me a bunch of people in the light with their eyes closed. What good does it do to you? But you are in the light. You are blessed. You are with the Bible. You are going to a church, right? You don't see anything. Your eyes are closed. No. He wants you to see and hear and believe. Faith brings this manifestation. It's almost like it comes between these two worlds, right? That's why faith is so amazing. The Lord says, if you have like a grain of mustard, faith, you'll tell this mountain to get up, uprooted, and throw him in the sea. It's like interesting. Faith is communicating between these two realms. And is making sure, is the assurance that whatever you say in this realm, because you use words, you use the language, but whatever you say here has a correspondence in the spiritual realm. That's what faith does. And when you have this relationship with faith, you know that. You know that you didn't just say a prayer. Something happens to you. It's alive. You hear these words and something happens inside you right now. It's not because you try to figure what I'm saying. It's because there is spiritual power that comes in your souls. And it says, yeah, I want this. I love this. This is the word. It changes me. So I call this the two kingdoms, this slide, because this is an interesting affirmation, a phrase. It says we manifest and express the kingdom we are most aware of. So if you are aware of what you are financially, if you are aware of, you know, your friends, your work, and everything that has dimensions, three-dimensional in this world, that's what you're going to manifest. So if somebody's going to come to you and you're going to say, hey, can I get a promotion or can I get an advice? The first thing coming to your mind is like, oh yeah, you have to call that person. You have to write an email. You have to do that. Why? Because that's what you're aware of. If you are aware of the living kingdom or the kingdom of God, you're going to say, okay, let's join hands and speak what you want in the name of Jesus. It's like, oh, okay. What does he do? Well, if you are aware of the spiritual realm, something will start happening. Right? Again, you are more than people and you can see. And the world, if you want a definition of the world, it's not really the ugly, the bad stuff that politicians make it even worse. It's not the military and the bad stuff happening all around the world. One of the definitions of the world that it talks about here is basically the outside projection. Just the realities that these five senses can see and perceive. The world is the place where Adam and Eve were thrown out of the Garden of Eden. They were thrown into this five senses perception, which were darkness and death. Now, people around you, they think they're alive, but they are dead if they only have that world. If you only live with those five senses and that world, they are actually dead. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead, right? That they cannot perceive beyond this. So you might go to them and might say, hey, I'm going to pray for that. It's like, it's a prayer does anything. I don't know. Let me go and find better medication. Right? So they cannot perceive beyond the five senses. So the world is this system of thinking, of values, of everything that's developed outside the relationship with God. There is no true God. There is a religion in there, but there's no God. Everybody from the world has a religion of trying to get in touch with God, right? They try to get back to God. They try to find God somewhere. That's religion, right? That's the definition of religions. All religions are defined basically there. That's the world. And he says there in 1 John 4:4, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. So suddenly, God did something. He brought a new realm, a new world, if you want, inside you. And for a while, you are like beings of two worlds. On the outside, you see this, and that used to be the real thing, right? Because that's all that you knew. But on the inside, the Lord develops a truth coming from the Word of God, cleansed by the blood of Jesus, develops the truth that you are saying, wow, whatever outside tells me is true, but is not the truth. The truth is what God says, and I'll stay with that. So, the world has no faith, rather a critical thinking. You like that, huh? And it's like, hold on. Let's try to logically assess your situation. Okay? And most of the time, you are in the same place by the end of the discussion where we are when you started the discussion, right? Because even if you might understand more things about your situation, there is no power to change it. Critical thinking doesn't bring power to change the stuff. And that's because there is no relationship with faith. Critical thinking doesn't have any relationship with faith. It's full of unbelief, right? The logic from the tree of knowledge, that's the one that they had from the fruit. John 1:10, he was in the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. That's pretty interesting. The religious world does not really have a relationship with the living God. They have some hope that he might exist somewhere, somehow, but doesn't have a relationship that changes with power who you are. So, how is God, the living God, bringing faith to you? It was very interesting how Christian talked about the understanding. See, if the understanding is not there, then you can have, we call it blind faith, you can act on it, but it doesn't give you the freedom to do it because you don't really understand what's happening. You cannot pray for this terminal disease unless you have the understanding of faith, unless you see exactly what the Word wants to say. You're just guessing. You are acting by faith. But there is an understanding that faith brings. Now, this is something that I brought up on Friday also, but I really want you guys to look at this, because I think our Father is not just giving us the power of believing, but also creates in us a way of staying in faith and spreading the faith. I believe that wherever Jesus went, there was faith all around him. I think it was easy for people to believe. I think the kingdom that he was carrying was making everybody not just desiring, but believing that. And people that had no idea, like the guy at Bethesda, you know, when Jesus said, okay, make your bed and come. 38 years. Never walked for that much. Complete paralytic. Could not even move from one place to another. Did you ever think about that? So somebody comes to you, you don't know what it means to walk. And he tells you, okay, get up, make your bed. What does it mean? I never got up. I don't know how to get up. What muscles do you use? How do you do that? You mean somebody's going to pick me up? The words of Jesus created faith in the people to listen to. Build up the faith so they can do what he told them to do. Okay? That's very important. He was walking on the streets. And people, I believe lots of people received that healing before they even, he was looking at them or praying for them. They would receive that. It was an atmosphere of faith. So the Lord is doing this for you, and you see that. You feel that in your soul. You see it around you. And he says here that as the rain and the snow come from above, so my word will make that seed that's planted to bring fruit. It doesn't say that the word is planting the seed. It says that the word is making that seed to pop up. This is what the season is coming into your life that is going to be easy for you to believe. He makes it in a way where he comes and you can take it. You can go with that. Peter speaks, first preaching of the basically New Testament church, and 3,000 people. Did you ask yourself, how did he do it without the microphone and amplifier? That's a good question I'm asking. How did everybody hear him? Because some people would not speak Aramaic. And he was not a speaker, really. I mean, it's not like this kind of a clear message that you could hear. And they were not translators. No headphones. How did Jesus go up on a mountain and there were like at least 5,000, let's say 10,000 people that he would speak to them? How would they hear? Pretty interesting, right? I think he had a little megaphone thing. It's like, hello, hello, I'm preaching the gospel. How did he do that? There was way more in the unseen world than the eye could see. There were so many. He was mentioning at one point 12 legions of angels. That's like a good number, I'm telling you. That's a good number. Probably more than every person that was in Israel at the time. So his words that were alive, there were angels that would translate that to people. People would hear him and receive the word. And more than that, would bring understanding to them. Because somehow they would believe that he is the Son of God. The spirit of faith had probably a ball. That was amazing. It's like, yeah, come on, Jesus, let's go. Let's get him. Let's get him all. Let's get him all. Think about this. I mean, this is amazing. He would go in a village, let's say maybe a few thousand people. It says all people got healed that night. How? I mean, how many lines so you can lay hands on every single one? No, it was way beyond laying hands. Was faith that would go and touch and cover the whole area. This is what he's doing with you. That's why people are drawn. This is how you understand when you walk in a place that is like a whole area that's affected by that place, by your walk in that place. Do you understand that? And this is the awareness that comes because the Lord says, I will make those seeds to come forth. Think about, you go in a public place, there are, you know, hundreds of people. Everyone, almost, especially in this country, has some seeds planted in them. To the grandpa, grandma, TV evangelist, radio, right? Can you imagine to walk in that place and all those seeds to receive a rain and start popping up? And pretty soon they'll say, hey, we're not hear you. Who are you? What's going on with you? Right? Because all those seeds will start coming up. That's pretty interesting. I know that's what happened with Jesus. And there are two types of seeds. There's the good seeds and there's the bad seeds. So I know that there will be times when you go in places and all kind of bad things might start happening also. Because the bad seeds are growing too. But everyone that has a seed from the Lord, a word sown into them, they'll be brought up and they would hear the word. We experienced this, and I told you this before, but we experienced that we went in places where we had to speak the gospel and the translator was busy. So we were in this kind of a Hindu village with a bunch of people who came, and the Holy Spirit said, just lay hands and speak to them. I'll save them. How do you speak an untranslated English, right? How can he do that? Well, he's God. Of course he can do that. When you are more aware of what you don't see, but it's absolutely real because the kingdom of God is alive in you and around you, you walk in a different way. You see, perceive, believe in a different way. It's easy. And Romans 10:17, very well-known verse. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Hearing comes by the word. Again, listen to this. Hearing the word. We're not talking about the seed again. We're talking about hearing comes by the word. See, that's the rain and the snow that come from above. Hearing. So when you start speaking to someone, believe that hearing comes to them. Because it's not what you're saying the right things. You know what to say. It's very simple. I mean, you've got so much word inside you. You've been talking to them. You've been blessing them. You got it. But they cannot hear you. So this is what he's doing. They can hear you from now on. Believe that hearing comes from the word of God. And if you want to pray maybe before you talk to someone, Lord, I want their ears to be open. I want them to hear. And then talk. You'll be surprised. Maybe talk to them for years, lots of years, and suddenly it's like, how come you never told me this? Are you kidding me? I've been telling you for so long, but you couldn't hear. Hearing comes from the word of God. Okay? And we'll do some exercises now with hearing, because I want you to hear the word, okay? So these are things that you probably read and you know about, and that's okay. John 10:18, no one takes it from me, but I lay down myself. He talks about his life. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This command I have received from my Father. You can study this. You can say, oh, Jesus was so amazing. or you can hear this for you. And I'm speaking now into all of you that hearing will come from the Word of God. Amen? Hearing will come. You can hear this now. Okay? So, it says, no one can take my life from me. And no one can take the life from my loved ones. Can you hear this? You are here probably to hear one of these words and to take it for you. No one can take your life. It is written. Can you hear it? No one can take the life from my loved ones. This is a command I have received from my Father. This is what you are hearing. This is my word. No one can take it from me. Okay? Let's say this, the second part. Let's say this together. No one can take my life from me. No one can take the life from my loved ones. This is the command I received from my Father. Is it how He's speaking to you? Okay, this is the truth. Number two. Romans 6:7. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Romans 6:14. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. See, hearing comes. Okay? Your logic, your mind can say, yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's in the Bible. That's okay. I understand. I believe it. But without hearing, faith is going to bring the deliverance. Right? Faith is going to bring the deliverance of the power of sin. And wants to do that if you hear it. Okay? If you hear that. He who has died, you have been crucified. According to the spiritual reality, you have died. 2,000 years ago, with Jesus, you have died. That's what the word says. Okay? So whatever this reality, this flesh tries to tell you, you can say, ha, 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 I'm a dead one. You cannot get it. You cannot win. You have no place in my mind because I have died. Can you hear this? I'm sure you can. Okay? Let's say the highlighted part together. I died with Christ, therefore I have been freed from sin. Sin has no dominion over me, for I am not under law, but under grace. Sin has no dominion over me. So next time these little things are popping in your mind, it's like, you know, I have to do this, or I cannot live without that, or all this, maybe an addiction, maybe a soul tie, maybe a soul pain, maybe things that are deep inside you. And hearing the word, this is going to be reminded to you. Either this is true and has power, or I'm just trying to get myself better. I would rather believe in humanism and improvements by thinking positive, right? I either hear the word of God and enter by faith in deliverance, or I'm just kind of religiously inch every day and get better until heaven. This is the source of deliverance. Okay? And the last one. 2 Timothy 1:7, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of sound mind. Anyone is dealing here with fear? Fear in the night, fear of darkness. Anyone is seeing things and maybe voices, maybe shadows. Everyone is fearing the future. It's so totally paralyzed of, oh man, what if that's gonna happen tomorrow? I have no idea, what should I do? Any type of fear, which is really the root of all the, most of the problems we are facing. Fear of not being loved, fear of not being received, fear of not succeeding, fear of being alone. Oh man, that's a big one. Fear of being alone, you know. Fear of being misunderstood. Fear of not making it in life. Fear of being poor. Fear of not having money. Fear of not being able to pay the bills. It's still fear, right? The word says he did not give you. That's not from God. Whatever logical thinking, critical thinking you have in your mind that tries to explain to you that you should keep that is not from God. He did not give you a spirit of fear. Amen? Did not. That does not belong inside you. So let's say that together. Fear has no place in me, but I am filled with power, love, and I have a sound mind. I love the sound mind thing. I love it. I heard about Dr. Professor Psychiatry here that she was for lots of years under depression, trying to kill herself and all this. And she had something she calls a religious experience where she saw something from the Lord, and she saw that that thing in her was pulled away. And her declaration was this: I was in hell, I know how it is, and I really made a promise that if I get out of there, I'll get everybody else out of that hell. And that's what she does. It's no power that that fear should have inside you. Let's stand up, please. Thank you, Father. Lord, I thank you right now. The Lord is showing you right now places in your soul, in your mind, in your body that can use deliverance, can use right now the power of deliverance. And I want you to start receiving by faith everything that you need for. Father, right now, this atmosphere of faith right here, that people can receive and take it in right now. And we command fear to leave the people right now. We command sickness to leave the people right now. We command in the name of Jesus, by the power of light, to deliver the soul of everyone that got a hold of faith. We thank you, faith. We thank you, faith, that you are going now from place to place in our souls, from person to person that's listening and hearing and is receiving now the deliverance, the healing, the change, the salvation, the power of God coming from the reality of a loving God. Thank you, Father. We receive that right now as one, as in unity. We receive that. Just put your hand gently on the person next to you. Oh, yes. And just speak into that person and say, you are receiving right now everything you need. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. And now the other person says, make sure both of you said the same thing. You are receiving right now everything that you need in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. We are right now praising you and thanking you, Lord, because in this atmosphere of faith, the power of God worked, the angels of God worked. We thank you that the Holy Spirit brought life and deliverance right now through every single one that's in this place and is hearing us. We bless you, Father, and we give thanks to you in the name of Jesus. And everyone says, amen, amen.